What's up? Welcome back, everybody. I'm Zesty Viking, and today we're joined by a special guest and also a special co-host today. Today I'm joined with Bad Jokes Brian. Brian, how are you, dude?
I'm doing great, man. I'm really excited. We got Lee here from Born Of Osiris.
Hello, hello.
Welcome in. Chilling. How you doing, Lee? How you doing today?
Doing good so far. Just made a coffee. I'm here with my dog. I don't know if he's in the... There he is. Is this Sniper? He, when I give somebody else attention, you guys right now, now he's all jealous, so...
Oh, well, don't worry. He'll have you in about an hour. most recently, you had a life-changing moment, and... a very inspiring story. Would you like to start with that and tell us a bit about it?
Yeah, it was kind of out of absolutely nowhere. I had no warnings from doctors or any issues previously medically. But I went to bed one night and I was active that night and just felt normal and great. And like 4 a.m, I woke up and my whole like abdomen was just the worst pain of my life. Like I knew like pretty much instantly that this was terrible, like just for the severity of the pain, and the intensity of it. But, I knew I had to go to the hospital immediately. There was no question. And, on the way, like, I remember I said out loud, like, I think I'm dying right now. Like the way that this feels, like, this is not a pain or like, you know, anything that's close to normal at all. And it's easier to laugh about now, but it turns out I was right. I was definitely dying. I'd had an infection in my pancreas, and we don't really know why that happened. It could have been, maybe drinking over the course of my career on the road. It could have been I was on a carnivore diet, which I'm not saying anything negative about, but red meat in particular is hard on the pancreas. So it could be a multitude of things. So we don't really know. But what had happened in my sleep was there was an infection of the pancreas that happened to spread to all my other organs. So when I woke up and felt that pain, all of my other organs had been infected pretty much, I would say, within a few hours I was asleep. And which was, I forget what it's called, but shock. What's it? Some sort of shock. Anyways. By the time we went to one hospital, they wouldn't see me or couldn't see me soon enough. I forget. This was an intense moment. And then I ended up, I live next to Baylor Hospital, which is a much larger hospital in downtown Dallas, and got there. At that point, I kind of just passed out and woke up a month later.
Oh, wow.
But, I was in a coma or 3 weeks. I don't want to exaggerate, but, during that time, I was like on all kind of, I guess you call it life support kind of deal. I have pictures of like 10, 15 different machines keeping me awake, dialysis, breathing, whatever. They'd gone through my mouth first. I think they stick the tube down your throat. But after 3 weeks, like your vocal cords are pretty fragile. And after 3 weeks, you can cause long-term damage. So they told my parents, like, because my family had flown to Dallas at this point in time, they had let them know that even if he wakes up from this, like, he might not be able to speak again. So then they did the tracheotomy, which is where they kind of cut through the front of your throat and go in and allow you to breathe that way. And it's funny, like, at that point, they usually say that's like not a good time, because if you're in a coma that long, and you could have brain damage, you could have a lot of things going on, which I was fortunate after being tested to not have anything. I'm very, very lucky in many ways, not only to be alive, but we have no issues with my brain at all, which is great. What's funny is they did the trach, and then they're like, that's not good. Usually this means they're going to be out for a while or forever. And I woke up like a day or two later. So I don't even know if it was necessary, but wow. I got a sweet little scar to show for it. And they did it like right on the line of my tattoo, which I'm thankful for. You can't even see it. But and then I woke up. I don't know what they were giving me. But the first week I was out of coma, I had a lot of questions for my family, because, again, I passed out at or arriving near the hospital. And so I didn't know I was in a coma. I woke up and I had questions. And I remember asking my mom, who was staying with me at that time, she said, "You were just in a coma for weeks." And I now remember her saying that, but then like 2 days later, I go, "Wait, what happened?" So it was a really weird time as far as memory goes. I still, like, people ask me about, you know, "Do you have any like dreams or something?" And I remember two when I, fairly, you know, within waking up, I think within a week or two, I remember two of them. And I remember like a third one recently. But like, yeah, just the memory of all of it is kind of fuzzy. And so like, even on the podcast I did where I kind of told the story, and even telling you now, it's one of those things where, it's just like what I had asked my family, you know what I mean? Like, I have no memory of really any of this, even waking up. I don't know what they have you on, but like, you're just foggy memory.
Right. Right. I'm assuming that, coming out of that though, I mean, you feel like you have like a new lease on life. I'm sure. And, I mean, you know, people don't get second chances too often. That's gotta be a pretty intense feeling to wake up to. And yeah, that was one thing I was wondering as well. Like, did if you had any, you know, one of those, you know, come to God moments or whatever, you know, kind of things, or if anything was like prominent when you woke up, you were like, "Oh my God, you know, I've got to do this or that, or I've got to think about this," and kind of stuff, you know, anything like that happened to you?
Yeah. I remember saying, to multiple people that, I don't know why this is the first thing I cared about, but they told me like, "This might not be over for you. Like, even still, I might have another month and four more surgeries." Mm-hmm. I left the hospital with my pancreas still healing, and it had like, some sort of, infection still towards like one part of it. And they're like, "You have a 50-50 chance when you go home right now that this gets better or it gets worse. And if it gets worse, we have to do four more surgeries." So anyways, the first thing I remember telling everyone is my new album, all the songs I have that are unreleased, they're on the desktop of my computer in my studio. Please make sure they get released. But like, those are the things that, I worried about first. But, also, you know, you're right, like the second chance thing. And, you know, as far as the coming to God moment, I haven't been religious in particular my whole life. I've never been a person who's like, "It's absolutely not true." Right. But I've never been the person who's like, "I'm a believer in any one book that happens to be on earth at this point in time."
Right.
But there's one thing I did think, and it was that, you know, I don't know how I got out that I was in the hospital, because again, I didn't know I was going or any of this was going to happen. But at some point I had seen when I woke up all of this just massive amounts of just positive comments and energy and emails and messages on Instagram or whatever it was. And I was, and my sister was saying like, "You understand like how many thousands of people were sending you love and prayer and energy and whatever it might be." And so as far as a coming to God kind of moment, that would be what one of them is that I don't know what, you know, the aspect of it would be, just the energy that I was getting. Maybe it's some sort of religious thing that, you know, whatever it is, I just felt that like the energy I was getting sent, the love, and just, I felt like that had to have done something. My mother does Reiki and she's all about energy and stuff like that. And again, nothing I dove too deep into, but, interesting nonetheless. And, yeah, it just seemed that, and also like the older I get too, the closer I even become towards feeling religious in a way, because, certain things just seem to just happen for a reason. And I used to say this mindset of, if it's meant to be, it'll be. I was always like, that's so fucking lazy. Like, so you can just sit on the couch, and if you're meant to be some great thing, it's just going to happen to you. I was like, that's a bullshit thing. And everyone says it, but I'm not buying it. But you know, as much as I didn't like the concept of it, as the more things go on, I'm just like, this is unbelievable. Like, for example, when I was in a coma, my mom was there. She took like a week off work or something. And then the day that she had to go happened to be like the first day that my dad could be there. And then the day he had to go happened to be like the first day that my brother could get off work. And so just like little by little, like every little thing kept it. So I had love in the room. I had family in the room. My wife at the time, who, you know, we're splitting up, but, you know, doing our best to remain friends and stuff, since she's my wife, only family is allowed in the hospital. She came in and, you know, regardless of whatever was happening at the time, just, you know, all that shit goes to the side, and you kind of just, you know, positive energy and love going multiple ways. And so, just all those little things. And then like one of the doctors was watching me, was a guitar player, and he was like, he got his shift ended, and he's like, "I feel like I'm the best person suited to keep," this was a bad point, sniper, please. This was a bad point in this time where, they kept saying one step forward, two steps back for the last three days. That they said, kind of get ready for, you know, possible bad ending here. And so the doctor was like, I got a feeling about this dude. I'm staying here and I'm going to stay past my shift. And so just all these little fucking things kept happening. And it just felt like it couldn't have been random. You know what I mean? Yeah. And so I don't know what I believe in, but I've definitely, since then, I've got multiple books, even a new version of the Bible. I'm reading a lot of things. I just feel something. Yeah.
So you're beginning to kind of feel more spiritual and.
Yeah. And I'm not saying any one book, I bought a Bible, but doesn't mean I'm all of a sudden Christian. I'm just doing my research because I don't feel anything's random anymore. You could ask me every 5 years that question and I might give you a different answer. I think it's a constant journey through life as far as what I truly believe in a different place in life. You might have a different answer, but nothing felt random about this to me.
Right. Go ahead, Jess.
Actually, Brian had a decent question he brought up to me, and I kind of want to transition to that, and it kind of revolves around while you were in a coma. This is kind of a weird one, but did it feel the length of the time, or did it feel like you had a dream and woke up?
It felt like I was on the way to the hospital, and then I woke up.
Jesus.
Wow.
And that a month had gone by. And I say a month. I was in a coma for 3 weeks, but I say a month because that first week out, I was awake and speaking, but like, I just don't remember any of it. I just have, like, for example, Jeff Kiesel, who is my guitar company, and all my band members and family members made videos for me and sent them to me when I was in a coma, like, hey, we love you. We know you're going to pull through this. You're strong, blah, blah, blah. And that first week, right when I woke up, my family showed me these videos. And then 3 weeks later, I'm home at this point. Thinking life is normal, well, not normal, but you know, normal-ish again. And so my sister brings up the videos. It's like, what videos? You know what I mean? So I was just like, I say a month because there's a month of this hell of blankness, you know. But it was it's a crazy time. It's a crazy time, but I feel all the love and you know, Jeff Kiesel, I consider him family, and they always say join the family. It is like a slogan of the brand, but like, you see in those moments, like, you know, even though I might sell a guitar for his company and there's a monetary relationship, a business relationship, you see in those moments, like how beautiful these relationships really are as far as, you know, they go much further than just business. And that's the kind of shit I want to be with, you know, that like, and another thing about him is like, he came to my wedding and made a guitar that like matched my wife's fingernails and found out in advance and surprised us. Like, you know, that's just one example of the relationships you find that, just bring joy coming out of a dark time like that. And even my family, like, you said second lease on life kind of thing. One of the things I feel like is I was never like a shit person, but I thought that everything I had was, just, I'd been used to it at this point in time. I've been 215 years, which instead of thinking, damn, I have the coolest job in the world, I would be like, well, this is what I do. And man, I don't really want to go to this country because man, the flight's a little long. And I'd be like, fuck, my perspective is way off because there's people that would dump their life savings into going to Europe or doing this or and to tour. And I mentioned family. And one thing about that is like, no ever issue with my family ever. But I remember thinking throughout my career, like, man, we don't talk all the time. Like, I don't call him, but he doesn't call me. And there was no issues, but it was just like, that's another thing. It's just like, my family is closer than ever now. I just got back from Chicago and going back in 2 days. And so, yeah, I mean, I think it's helpful to find the silver lining in darker times, which is what I'm trying to do.
I think you need to, move back to Chicago. Let's go. Come on.
that's what I'm, it's on my mind for sure. You know, I mentioned splitting with the wife, hope to remain friends, but I was really here for her. You know what I mean? Like, because we were long distance at the beginning. And I remember thinking like, if we're going to go get serious about this, I'm going to be on tour 6 to 9 months out of the year. And when I'm gone, it's nice that she could have her family and friends. So I kind of moved here for that situation to be beneficial to her with my touring schedule at the time. So right now, as far as I'm concerned, like my little brother and sister, I haven't really been in their lives as much as I'd like to with touring their whole life. And my parents are getting older and healthy, but still it's on your mind. And, my band's there. And so, yeah, Chicago's definitely something I think, highly about going back to.
Yeah. It's, I was listening to, your podcast and you mentioned something that was interesting. You were talking about, the Motley Crue. You'd pop in Motley Crue when you first got your license and you were driving back roads, you know, around in Chicago, because there are some stretches of, you know, and it's funny because I live locally in Chicago, and I kind of have an idea of where you were talking about in those areas where you just floor it and you're within the woods just zipping through. And yeah. So yeah. When you were talking about that, I'm like, I'm picturing like Kickstart My Heart and you're flying, you know.
Oh yeah. So those are such great memories, man. I think a lot of people, you know, that age of 16 to 18 is just super memorable, hopefully, you know. I just remember, yeah, I had this piece of crap car, but couldn't tell. I could have been like the coolest car on planet Earth in my mind, because you're just cruising down these roads, no cops in sight, Motley Crue's blasting, and it's just, yeah, I'll never forget those times. And I just did it again last week. I was in Chicago, and I drove my car down, and I was like, you know what? This is full circle. Oh, yeah. I stayed back roads from my childhood. And just doing it was just, man, it was a really, I feel like I lived more life in that week than I've lived in months of time elsewhere, because of just like how I went back and retraced all the steps of kind of life and coming out of a coma and stuff. Like, I remember like my last podcast, I felt like it was super deep about like how intense that shit was, but I was like, you know what? It's that time in my life right now. I'm going to just own it and live it. And, it just made that whole experience in Chicago magical, to work with my band again that I hadn't seen. Magical to see family again under positive circumstances instead of such terrible ones. And just, you know, going on those roads, something so simple, listening to music you used to listen to as a kid, is just like, I feel like it healed me, man. It was crazy.
As a musician, how does it feel, man? I know you grew up, you fell in love with the guitar, your dad busted his ass to ensure that you were able to, you know, be able to continue to do guitar lessons, you know, so that you can really, you know, sink your teeth into something that you loved, and you wouldn't have to work a day in your life. You could do something that you love. How does it feel knowing that you have a signature guitar, right? And what is it that you have against headstocks?
As far as the signature guitar, that's one thing I feel very lucky about. I remember, like, so I've been playing for like 23 years now, and I remember when I was younger, it was all about like, I want to be the fastest fucking dude at the guitar, and like, I was probably faster then than I am now, if anything. But like, I was about that, like, that race of like, let's be a part of this. And as I get older, I learn there's always gonna be someone younger and faster on YouTube. So as I get older, I find my voice on the guitar. But the point I bring that up is to say that there are so many deserving guitar players, more so than me, than to have a signature guitar. So I feel absolutely blessed, and to have it with someone like Jeff Kiesel, who, again, like I've said on this interview podcast, that he's like family, and I truly love the guitars. And as far as the headstock, yeah, man, it's funny. Like, I didn't think about them for a while. I had a signature model with a headstock, and I would be like in a couch like this, and I would notice that, like, especially if you're with like a partner in your life, and you know, you're sitting next to him with this bulking guitar, and you'd be surprised how much, like, whatever, like 8 inches of headstock takes up space wise. So for multiple reasons, here's what I like. I like that I can have a guitar right next to me at all times, because it's literally like right there, and it's just like, it's not that big, and I can just fucking shove it right into the couch next to me, into the cushion. Also, first record, The New Rain, we recorded when we were in high school, and I had a Gibson SG. And so it was in a hard shell case. So flew to California. We did the record, and flying back, I opened the case and the neck is snapped in half. So no. So that guitar's died, and the last thing it did was The New Rain. But since that guitar died, I had been really crazy about like my favorite guitars, not wanting to check them again, because I'm pretty sure, if I remember correctly, there's a thing that says, if anything happens to a musical instrument on an airplane, we're not responsible. And they kind of make you sign it sometimes. Sometimes they don't. Because I remember I've flown a million times with guitars, and I don't always sign it. But in this particular situation, whatever, maybe it was the airline, they had pretty much opted out of the liability, and I had signed on it. And so since then, I would be like, shit, I'm going to – if it's like – I have one guitar that it like doesn't leave my side. And I'd be like, I'll buy a seat for this guitar and fucking seatbelt it right next to me at this point.
The blue one?
Yeah. Blue and purple. Mm-hmm. And so, which is expensive, and we're not in a genre that's just like bursting with money at every level. But, mm-hmm. So the point is, the cases these guitars with the hot headstocks come in are, they look like a violin to some people. They're, you know, in size. And now the best part about it is overhead storage. They're small enough that they don't make you check them. So it's a carry on. So just the size that you lose with the headstock, you can carry the thing on. And I even like turn the case backwards and I'll angle my body to where you can't see that it's anything more than a briefcase. So that's another tip and trick. And then the third thing is, as far as no headstock goes, is points of contact. I can't say a world of difference, but I will say this, like if you have a string vibrating, for example, like when you touch it, it stops vibrating, of course, just the concept of that. So on these, there's two points of contact. On the headstock, you create a third, and it's behind the bridge, so it doesn't do a ton of difference, but the nut at the top of the neck, it's past that, the third point of contact. So I haven't noticed a world of difference, but the word on the street is they sustain a bit longer.
So is that kind of like, real quick, can you show me that? Well, the theoretical headstock, because one of the things is
tuner thing on it right now.
Okay, but. Yeah, because John Five is one of my like influences, and what he does is he'll bend behind the nut. So like certain things, that kind of renders that out completely, doesn't it?
It does. So if that's something you do, this is not the guitar for you. Yeah. I've never done it.
But I mean, I've been looking at Kiesel, and well, I can only look at Kiesel. I can't afford them right now. Yes. But eventually, one day.
Yeah, they've been. That was a top of conversation making the guitars. Is like when they tell you like, hey, make a signature model, and it can be anything you can dream up. And it's like, okay, I want to go nuts. I want it to have every fucking feature. I want it to have like everything you could ever want. And then they show you the price tag and you're like, well, shit, like that's not going to be attainable to people that are just working on it and make an honest living. And so that is a conversation that I had with them, because I wanted to put the piezo on it, which makes it in the bridge to where it sounds like an acoustic guitar, and there's a switch. So it's funny. I'm getting ahead of myself, because it's a single coil Strat version of my guitar, and I removed the piezo switch and I gutted it. I've done a lot to this guitar. This is like, it's my signature guitar, but I've like redone it like multiple times, chasing certain tone. But in the guitar, I have a piezo to make it sound like an acoustic, and you can blend it so you can get the best clean tones I've ever heard.
Now, are we going to hear those clean tones on the new record?
Yeah, you are. Ooh, okay. And, but the thing with that is like that feature costs, what, $300 extra? It adds money to the guitar. So in creating it, you have to be mindful that you know, you want to make the guitar still accessible to people that can't just drop thousands on a guitar. So yeah, no, I feel you, man. It's one of those things. I've been very fortunate enough in the guitar world to, you know, I don't know what my collection would look like if I had to, you know, pay for all of it, you know, and I just understand lucky in that aspect.
So, right, yeah. You guys have seen a lot of success with your latest release, Angel Alien. What is there to expect from this new record? Are you able to talk about the new record? Well, obviously there's nothing out yet leaked or anything, but what can you tell us to expect from this next upcoming album?
Yeah, so the whole of our career, Cameron the drummer and myself have been the songwriters of I call them the skeletons. So we'll provide a song, all the instruments. And things change as far as like the vocalists will like rearrange the structure. For Discovery, we had Jason, and he would be like, I want to add a solo, kind of stuff like that. But for the most part, everything has just been Cameron and me, instrumentally, I should say.
Right.
Up until we got Nick Rossi. When Nick came around, it was on, I think the Simulation is the first one that he... Yeah, the Simulation is the first one that he started writing, and his writing is unbelievable. Yeah, it's like Born of Osiris with like this Lamb of God vibe into it. Yeah. And like, and so I would say since then, if you've heard any kind of like new vibe, that probably is the addition of Nick Rossi. And so I would say Simulation did great for us. It was, I think maybe if I were to critique myself on maybe the records before that, or maybe I'd gotten a bit comfortable in my songwriting. There was moments where I'd be like, what's worked for us previously? And then I would try to do that again. But that's not necessarily the most honest way to go about music, or the most integral way to go about songwriting. So I still love every record. It's fine. But I'm just, if I had to critique myself, I would say maybe I got a little bit safe. And so I think Nick came in and we were like, and he has a cool view of the band too, because he was a fan of the band from the outside. And so he, when we're inside it, we have this, we're like in a room and all we see is what's in the Born of Osiris room. And he got to see that room from the outside looking in and maybe even think like, hey, what would I want to change in that room? And so he's coming in as someone who understands the sound that we've created and wants to give to it. But also you get this person who goes, well, what would I do if I was there? And so it's a really unique thing. So since Simulation, he's been an amazing help. And then we did Angel or Alien. And you'd mentioned about the success of it, which I agree. But the punishing part about it is that the pandemic affected everybody. So like that record was so well received. However, like the amount of touring we got to do made it almost feel like it never happened in a way. Right. So that's a bummer.
It was a bummer. I thought that album was great. I actually, so much so that I'm gonna nerd out real quick.
Nice. Oh yeah.
My wife bought me the hot pink and neon green vinyl.
That's awesome. Yeah. She seems cool. As far as the new record, so I'm excited about this one. I'm excited about everyone, and I think everyone thinks their most recent work is their best. However, if I take myself out of that, I can say this. Every record we've done previously, let's say we have 8 songs, then 8 songs go on the record. Let's say we have 14 songs. 14 songs go on the record. This time we have like 25 songs. And we're going to pick the best of the best, and it's going to hurt to let some of them go, but we're going to pick the best of the best and make a, you know, maybe 10 to 14 song album. And on top of that, not only are we picking the best from a group, which we've never done before, this is the first time that vocally, we're all like, sometimes we go to the studio and we'll do the record instrumentally. And while we're doing that, Joe and Ronnie are kind of like in another room still writing vocals or, you know, starting to record then. Right now, like they're already tackling vocals for all 20 songs, because we said if we're going to have to cut 20, 25 songs down to 10 to 15, then I have to hear vocals on them, because for example, I wrote one song called Under the Gun. Instrumentally, it was kind of like not that intense. And it almost had a vibe to where I was like, is this even like acceptable in the Born of Osiris world? Cause it's not exactly crazy technical heavy. However, once the vocals are over it, I thought it gave the song new life. And then sometimes you have a song that you're so passionate about, and this of course isn't a diss on anybody, but this is writing. Mm-hmm. And then the vocals happen and you're like, okay, it maybe didn't end up where I want.
Right.
And so for this, we're like, if we're going to actually cut down songs, we need vocals for every single one of them. And so that's what we're doing right now. When I was in Chicago, we did 2 or 3 songs. And also me being a part of the vocals is something I haven't probably since maybe Discovery, because that's usually like their Ronnie and Jason, Discovery, Ronnie and Joe kind of thing. It's kind of like their sacred little thing. But this time around, it's like, I find that as far as vocals go, you have music that I would say overall for us is more, I guess, technical and rhythmic, our music, right? Mm-hmm. So when you have like stuff that can get busy at times instrumentally, and then you have 2 vocalists for the most part, that can also make things feel a little wild. Like, so you have busy music and then you put busy vocals over it, it can almost be too much. So I do want to be there for vocals, because I feel that I have, at least for the songs I write, and I'm sure that's how Nick feels about his songs and Cameron feels about his songs, that like you kind of have the heart of the song, like you feel it in your bones, and mm-hmm. you have a lot to offer as far as at least patterns. I think I said like 3 lyrics that ended up, you know, on the album the other day. However, the patterns is what I was mostly contributing to, because they've got lyrics locked down. But yeah, it's exciting because, like I said, so to wrap this long thing up, big body of work, being slimmed down to the best of best, and vocally you have more of a group effort than more of a Joe and Ron effort.
Yeah, I think just as an outside perspective, you can actually hear the extra influences. Like you were saying, you could kind of hear that, you know, Nick's influence, and you can hear that. And I'm wondering too, because of, you know, with whenever you all released the simulation, from what I can recall, that was supposed to be like a part one of a two-part release. And I'm assuming Angels and Alien, or Alien, I'm sorry. I swear to God. Angels or Alien. Was that supposed to be part two? Because I know you guys like went back and like during COVID, because of that, you didn't release it initially as quickly as you wanted to because of COVID. So you went back and like did more to it, and it ended up being a more expansive, right? Was that part two initially? Was that supposed to be?
Yeah, so it was supposed to be a two-part thing, but like I think for all of us, or I'll speak for myself, at least as far as songwriting goes, like that's my favorite part about being in a band. I love touring and it's fun, but being in the studio writing music, and that moment you get when you finish a song and you press play and you walk around your studio, it's better than like any drug. And it's like, it's my favorite thing. If I could, you know, pick one feeling to just like make last forever, it's being proud of a new piece of art that you've created. And so because of that, I don't stop writing when a record's done. So for example, we had these two parts, and by the time Simulation came out, dude, every time you hear a song by Born Of Osiris, it's probably written 2 years ago. Yeah. It's really frustrating the way that the industry works and how to release stuff, man. Like there's such a beauty to me of being a dude who just creates on your own with no team, and you can fucking write a song and put it up instantly. There's a beauty to that. Not enough for me to chase it. I'm proud of our team at Sumerian and everything. There's no issues there, but it's just like, it's frustrating. Anyways, by the time Simulation came out, myself, Nick and Cameron, like we had more songs. Yeah. And so we're like, well, shit, like let's, and when I record something, as far as writing goes, I always have fresh strings on my guitars. I tune before like every damn thing I do. If I'm playing here, I'm going to tune right there. Like everything's perfect when I record it, and I record the DIs. And so when I write a song, like that's it. Like I'm not going to go to a studio and do the same thing again. However, if you put me in a room with like Adam D from Killswitch and he wants to do guitars, I'll do that. Sure. But my point is sometimes people go to producers and they're like, this guy's like, he'll give you the best fucking vocal production ever. And it's like, cool. Well, you got my guitars. We're good. You know what I mean? Like my point is that, by this time Simulation came out and all the songs we had made were recorded instrumentally. You know, that means all Cameron has to do is just track the drums. Cause when writing, we'll do program drums, but obviously you don't want that on a record. So it was so easy to just be like, you know what, if we don't put these songs on this part two thing now, it's going to be fucking 2 years before these things come out. And so like, we're basically said, all right, scrap the part two. All those songs are on Angel Alien. So nothing got scrapped, but, we just added songs to it. And so we're stoked on that. You got, instead of, I think Angel Alien might have been 14 songs, if I remember correctly. I could be totally wrong, but I think it was going to be only 8. So you would have gotten only 8 on part two, but it turned into, I think, 3 more songs.
Man, I'm going to tell you right 14. Now, Angel, it was a fantastic record, by the way, and they translate so well live. I'm waiting for the day. I know you guys didn't really have a break in order to really rehearse anything really new, like to add to the set list, really, from, you know, tour to tour to tour. Because like I said, I've caught you guys 3 times in the last year, and it was tough for you guys to have a break to do that. I totally get that, because you have to program all, you know, the clicks and all that stuff. Anyway, I'm waiting for the day for Waves to be added, and I want to hear, you know, Unfold. I want to hear it.
Yeah, I want to do that as well. I always make the joke that we need to play that live.
Yes.
Because then I get a microphone on stage.
Oh, shit. I made that mistake, Lee. I made that mistake, and I'll tell you right now, once you get it, you're going to take advantage, and then they're going to want to take it away, and you won't let them, man.
I'm talking. I got things to say, guys.
Uh-huh. Let's go. Okay, so I got one for you. And this is actually a Brian question. I'm stealing from you, Brian, because it's a great question. he's like, motherfucker. So your creative patterns and strumming patterns within Born of Osiris itself, and just your solo work for, like, for instance, Stormridge, like, it's incredible. The strumming patterns. How do you come up with such fast and strange patterns?
So just freestyle. So basically, like, I remember like Lil Wayne used to be like, I freestyle every line in the studio and the thing I say, a thing ends up like, that's how it is in the record. Well, to be honest, like that's kind of how I approach writing breakdowns. For example, one particular breakdown in a song called Open Arms of Damnation Cameron wrote, there's a breakdown like three quarters of the way through it. And this is the approach he did it on this song. And this is the same approach that we'll both take. I'll start with cymbals, riding and snare, and I'll just run that. And if you want to throw in kick, go ahead. You gotta have your DAW open for people. Maybe I got too ahead of myself. You're in your recording program. You got your tempo, your setup. Run cymbals, snare. You can ride a double kick throughout. Do whatever you want. But it's important that you know where your snare is, or even if you don't have snare, at least that you're riding the tempo. But so I'll freestyle, like hip hop. I'll freestyle these patterns and I'll do that for 30 seconds, a minute, whatever. And then I'll go back and listen to the parts I like. And let's say I did a minute of this, then 10 seconds is what I like. Okay. So I delete everything around it. And then I just make the kick match what I did and then put the snare placement where I want it. And now you have this breakdown. And what I like about that is it's almost new to you because you created it, but like you did it with such a freestyle approach that listening back, it's almost like someone else wrote it. So that gives it shelf life internally. And what I mean by that is like, when I said it takes 2 years for a song to come out, I'll be so excited when we finish the record and be like, this is our best work. I'm so excited about this. I love these songs. 2 years later, by the time they come out, it's almost like I've heard them too many times. I'm not excited anymore. And I hope people are excited. But at this point, they've lost their like luster to you. And now everyone's hearing it for the first time. You have to try to remember like how you felt the first time you heard it. But doing things that way makes it less stale and they live longer for me is in a fun way. Whereas I'm personally not good at, I've never applied myself to Guitar Pro, but I know people that write in Guitar Pro and they have great results. Mm-hmm. I just personally don't. And I like to create with my guitar in a live, it's not live, it's studio, but in a live way. And so in those moments, things last longer as far as keeping me interested in listening back, if that makes sense.
Okay. Yeah. I've seen people like on TikTok, they'll make these videos. They'll be like, oh, today I'm going to write a breakdown to this and it'll be whatever tempo. And they'll have a deck of cards or they'll have a die that they'll roll. And it, you know what I mean? They'll be like, all right, that means a triplet. All right. That means a six, you know, strums or this is a break, you know, and stuff like that. And I didn't know if you guys have ever tried anything like that, or if it was something along the lines of just letting it ride on the click track and just letting it roll and you just strum and then you listen back, you're like, oh man, that part right there, I'm gonna clip that, we'll cut that and we'll put that with this part that sounds really cool, you know, like
it's the latter for me. And yeah. But I have seen ATB After the Burial
do
that. I, for example, Pi, this breakdown they have, like they literally just took the numbers of Pi and made it into a breakdown. So I've seen them do that and it turned out incredible, but everything they do to me is incredible. Mm-hmm. I've seen them do it, possibly Veil of Maya, and we kind of all grew up together, Veil of Maya and After the Realness. So, but yeah, for me and Cameron, it's more of that freestyle approach. Okay.
What is the best piece of advice that has been given to you early on in the career or throughout your career that you still use and apply to this day?
Man, I don't know if I can answer the question as far as early in career, but I feel like throughout different periods, I learned important lessons. And one of them was, let's just take, for example, what I said about feeling like I got a little comfortable for a record or two. Like basically, here's an example. One day I wrote a song called Machine for us, which potentially is one of our bigger songs ever. If not, I think on streaming services, it might still be. But Ash, the owner of our label, said, Lee, if you give me 10 machines, I'll make you a millionaire or whatever. Some big amount of money. And I remember thinking like, okay, well, who doesn't want that? So I was like, all right, I just analyzed what I did. Dude, I wrote Machine in 10 minutes. This girl was in my bathroom, like taking too long to get ready. And I was like, fuck, I'm going to write some music. And I wrote Machine in like 10 minutes. And then there's songs that I spent a month doing, 2 months doing. And I was like, why, what is it about Machine? And so I was like, all right, maybe it's the tempo. Let's do a couple songs in the same tempo. And I was like, all right, well, let's do songs in like maybe similar structure. are like, okay, well, maybe we should have like a shreddy part and a powerful chorus, whatever. And so what I spent a while doing was analyzing what I had done naturally in 10 minutes, natural art with integrity that just came as it was, overanalyzing and trying to give 10 more machines. And so, again, I don't think I'll attempt to never release anything that I don't stand behind. And I haven't released anything that I don't stand behind, but I can say that during a period of time, I spent too long not being exactly what I wanted to be and maybe chasing, what works. And that's not a negative thing either. For example, if people love Machine and that's the one that they've chosen to latch onto the most, me trying to give them more of what they like, it's not devilish. You know what I mean? There's no harm intended in this. But what I'm saying is, as far as being, having music, I keep saying it with integrity, you can't force those things. And so I would say that, instead of analyzing so hard what's popular and what's working and trying to like make your own version of it, of something that already is there and is in its purest form, the first form, just write what makes you happy. And I think that, you know, it's hard for people to think of sometimes because they may think, well, man, if it was up to me, I would make like a bluegrass metal band and no one's going to want to listen to that. Well, dude, you don't know that. And if it's honest, do that, because you could spend 10 years following trends. And if you look at it this way, like, let's say there's the curve, you're always going to be behind the curve. So you're looking forward to the same curve of what to follow. Like if all you're doing is staring ahead and what's working, you're always behind. I made electronic music briefly, and loved it and learned so much. But what I was doing at that time was I was looking at what was like, you know, on Beatport, and I was like, what are people doing right now? Okay, I want to be inspired. What I had soon realized from that was that all I'm doing is taking inspiration from the thing that the curve that I'm always going to be behind if I'm looking on the curve for my source of inspiration. So if that makes sense, I would just say do what you love and worry less about what'll come of it.
When can we expect your solo project, your latest solo project to release?
Yeah, so the one I'm doing right now is number 3, and it's at a place where I think all my work is done on it. I have like 2 or 3 open sections that I want to. I was originally going to just put saxophone there, which is usually my go-to. I've been working with Adrian from the Mars Volta. He's in Tram as well. And then actually this saxophone player from the 1975 is, I've been working with him as well, which is a very interesting pairing. And I'm enjoying that. And I literally woke up today and was reminded that I need to email him as well to get him on again. But I also, you'd mentioned, Brian, I think the one chord progression, like just riding it, or one melody riding throughout. There's one song on the record that I'm still doing because it is one chord progression the whole song. And that's not something I usually do. Like, I like the repetition of this chord progression, drive it home and make you feel familiar when it comes back. That's very important, especially in chorus. But this one song is the same chord progression the entire time. And I wanted to find ways with the bass guitar, because it started on piano, this particular song. And I wanted to find ways with bass guitar to like play certain notes within those chords to where the verses and the choruses felt different, because even though they're the same chords, I wanted to use the bass to pick apart different notes in those chords to make it feel not so repetitive.
Right.
Anyway, so it just felt weird to me. I was like, what the hell? It's like, it's obviously in key. I'm like literally analyzing the chords and putting it on the bass and just trying different notes from the chord. So anyways, I sent it off to Nick Sampson, who does a band called I'm Abomination, but he recorded some of our stuff previously and taught me a lot of what I know about recording through the years. And he's an unbelievable guitar player. He actually wrote the other half of me guitar solo with me together. So like we have done a lot of stuff together that people probably don't even know about. But I sent him, I'm like, dude, am I losing my mind over this bass shit here? Because at this point I've listened to it so many times, I feel like I don't even know what's right or wrong anymore. But I was like, hey man, I sent him the whole record and I was like, if you feel any of these empty spots could be good for a guitar solo, you're one of the few dudes I would ask to do so. So he might be on it. That's up to him. So it's to the point where I needed to hit up the few people that I want to just guest on a couple spots. And I would say next year for sure it'll come out. Because like I said, like, I mean, if I had to finish it up this week, I could. But just want to get the right people to fill the right gaps. As far as Born of Osiris, we have some touring lined up next year, I think starting in February. And so we want to have some singles out, even if it's one. So right now we're trying desperately to get those, without rushing, to get those 20, 25 songs done on vocals in a demo place, give them to the label, because they like to have a hand in picking out singles. And we hope to have something out by like February. But next year you should see new Born of Osiris album and my third solo album.
Hell yeah. That's awesome.
Lee, I want to thank you so much for your time, dude. This has been great. I had a blast. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, Lee McKinney, Born of Osiris, solo project coming out next year.
Well, thanks for having me. I appreciate you guys' time. Absolutely. And excited as well.
If you like the content that you are seeing, do me a favor and smash your face against that subscribe button, like the video, and follow us up for more content such as metal interviews and news.